of attempts to fix the system. The history of the prison is the history of prison reform. The prison itself was a reform introduced around the turn of the 19th century as a way of expressing that the punishments, corporal punishments, capital and corporal punishments, were undemocratic. This is around the time of the American Revolution, all the new discussions of democracy. And then reform later, in the 19th century, say around the 1870s, led to specific architectures and regimes for women. The women's prison is introduced, which is often patterned after youth reformatories. And then in the 1930s, rehabilitation becomes the focus. It becomes the emphasis of reform efforts. In the 1970s, and many of you are probably familiar with the Attica Rebellion. In the aftermath of the Attica Rebellion, there was a wave of calls for prison reform. As a matter of fact, the Attica Uprising produced a list of demands that helped to drive this reform movement. And this came from the prisoners themselves. You can Google Attica demands. There are something like, I have all of the demands listed. There are something like 25 of them. 27. And I don't have time to go through each one individually, but I will say that they address legal representation at parole boards, better medical staff and medical policy and procedure, adequate visiting conditions, an end to the segregation of prisoners from the mainline population because of their political beliefs. And incidentally, there's still a huge number of political prisoners behind bars. And I would love to see Obama address that. But as a matter of fact, I'd like to see Obama grant clemency to political prisoners, like limit health care. A number of the demands revolve around labor. We demand that inmates be granted the right to join or form labor unions. And that they be granted the right to support their own families, working on scale wages. This was 1970. They were calling for scale wages for prisoners who worked. And, well, we know what's been happening in New York, all of the revelations regarding repression and brutality behind bars. Number 12 of their demands, we demand an end to the escalating practice of physical brutality being perpetrated upon the inmates of New York State prison. Unionized vocational training, recreational training. And this one, number 18, is really interesting. We demand that the present parole board appointed by the governor be eradicated and replaced by a parole board elected by the popular vote of the people. In a world where many crimes are punished by indeterminate sentences, and where authority acts with secrecy and within vast discretion, and are given heavy and give heavy weight to accusations by prison employees against inmates. Inmates feel trapped unless they are willing to abandon their desire to be independent men. And I mention that in particular because, and I want to talk a little bit about indeterminate sentences, but I'm seeing number 20 is an immediate end to the agitation of race relations by the prison administration. An end to the discrimination in the judgment and quota of parole for black and brown people. And so it goes on and on. You see, this is better food. End to the unsanitary conditions. And so finally they say, we are firm in our resolve and we demand as human beings the dignity and justice that is due us by our right of birth. We do not know how the present system of brutality and dehumanization and injustice has been allowed to be perpetrated in this day of enlightenment. But we are the living proof of its existence, and we cannot allow it to continue. The taxpayers, who just happen to be our mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, daughters, and sons, should be made aware of how their tax dollars are being spent to deny their sons, brothers, fathers, and uncles of justice, equality, and dignity. Now, I mentioned indeterminate sentencing because one of the major reforms that occurred during that period was the abolition of indeterminate sentencing. But what was it replaced with? Mandatory minimum. And so what appeared to be a humane reform that would make life better for our people behind bars ended up becoming one of the most repressive arms of the criminal justice system. And I use this as an example because oftentimes it's not immediately clear how reforms can actually strengthen repression. How reforms can actually strengthen a system that perhaps needs to be replaced with something else. And I'm not saying that we don't need any reforms. Of course we need reforms. But the measure of whether reforms will actually be helpful in the long run, I think, resides in the question of whether or not it makes life better and more habitable for those who happen to be in prison, not whether it will strengthen the institution of the prison, not whether it will make more permanent the prison and its practices of the practices that fill it over incarceration. Now, what gets left out in many of the proposed reform strategies that are designed to repair the damages of mass incarceration is the fact that there are corporations reaping enormous profits from a punishment system that has spun out of control. And of all of the discussions, I have not encountered this absolutely essential element of what is often called mass incarceration. This is why we talk about a prison industrial complex. The reliance on prisons to solve social problems is a trend all over the world. And why the juggernaut of privatization has to be linked to our understanding of the problem of the prison, the neoliberal assumption that anything can be a source of profit. Human beings can be marketed. And so the prison crisis, I think, cannot be solved without dismantling what we have come to call the prison industrial complex, which relies on racism as the fuel for a profit-driven practice of punishment. The prison crisis requires us to understand not only the role of race and how structural racism helps to drive this over-incarceration, but the role of gender. First of all, women seem to get left out of all of the discussions around prison. And it's true that women constitute a relatively small minority of prisoners all over the world. But it's also true that if one looks closely at the predicament of women in prison, one gets a much more complex sense of the work that mass incarceration accomplishes. One is compelled to ask questions about the relationship between institutional violence, state violence, on the one hand, and intimate violence on the other. And one begins to recognize the extent to which this symbiotic relationship between institutional violence and institutional violence and intimate violence drives the prison industrial complex. And also, more recently, people involved in the abolitionist campaign have come to recognize how essential it is for an accurate analysis of racism and the prison crisis to look at the situation of transgender prisoners. Trans prisoners are able to reveal not only the transphobia and racism and all of its intersections, but the way the prison as an institution is also a gendering apparatus. And so the work, the recent work that has been done around trans prisons is a really good anthology that was published a couple of years ago by Matt Smith and Eric Stanley, that's called Captive Embodiment, Trans Prisoners and the Prison Industrial Complex, Trans Bodies and the Prison Industrial Complex. And also it's important to understand the reach of the prison industrial complex without recognizing that the same incarceration practices are used on immigrants. And that as a matter of fact, the most profitable sector of what we call the prison industrial complex resides in privatized detention facilities for immigrants. And I want to know, when we're talking about trying to eradicate mass incarceration, why the discussion of immigrants completely falls out of the frame? It means that we fall prey to the kind of provincialism that is so distinctly American. And when I say American, I mean U.S., you know, not American in the largest sense. The provincialism, the inability to think beyond this space, the assumption that we are the center of the world. And I think younger generations are recognizing that not only are we not the center of the world, but we are responsible for so many of the problems the world is experiencing now, and especially the fact that the sign of U.S. democracy has become the prison. Wherever the U.S. goes to save democracy, they bring prisons. So the system can't be fixed. If the system can't be fixed, maybe it can be abolished. Addressing problems that this criminal justice system pretends to but cannot solve. And let me say that there's been a lot of discussion about policing over the last year. And policing, as we know, should also be abolished. The global reach of policing, emphasized by the extent to which people all over the world took up the cause of Ferguson, especially Palestinians who suffer the violence of settler colonialism. We know settler colonialism in this country, of course. This country was founded on settler colonialism and the genocidal assaults on the indigenous people of this land. So I would say that we need new conceptions of security that do not rely on police and prisons as the anchors of a notion of security that assumes that more repression, more violence can create security. So what might security mean in a more productive context? You know, I would think security would mean education, the ability of every person in this country to get an education, regardless of how much money they might be able to claim. It would mean jobs, it would mean healthcare,